story time about when I messed up visiting a Nazi concentration camp. A few years ago, my uncle invited my friend and myself along to a trip to Poland. He was planning on visiting the Auschwitz Memorial and Museum and the concentration camp. I said yes because I felt it was important for me to learn about the details of what went on. I was still quite young and had only learned more general information about the war and the camps, never really bothered to do my own research. You know how it goes. Let me set the scene a little here. The morning of, I had arrived and we were all ready to go. I was unsure of the weather. It was hot and humid, but it would likely rain later and cool down a bit. My friend looks at me and goes, "Are you gonna wear that?" And I said yes, thinking that this shirt was probably warm enough in case it got colder, so I won't even need to bring a jacket. All right then, off we go. We get to the first camp and the tour begins. It was fascinating and horrifying, but I suppose that is to be expected. As our group makes its way through the camp, I'm surprised by how much information is completely new to me, and how much worse it is than I'd initially learned. At some point, we go into the building where they showcase the suitcases, shoes, hair, things like that. I think we're about half an hour, maybe more, into the tour, which would take a few hours total. I stay close by the tour guide so that I can hear him better. The guide then leads us to a room where they showcase the prisoner uniforms. It was at this point that I realized I fucked up. I'm standing next to the tour guide and the prisoner uniforms, absolutely mortified. The shirt I was wearing looked exactly like the prisoner uniforms. I had no idea that was what my friend was trying to warn me about, with bleach blonde hair and blue eyes to boot. When we get outside, I asked why no one said anything before we left. My friend said she did, so she figured I knew and was trying to make some kind of statement. Hadn't I ever seen the boy in the striped pajamas? I hadn't, nor any type of other media that showed the uniforms or details of prisoner life. Somehow I managed 18 years or so avoiding the specific detail that would come back to bite me. I was stuck feeling like an asshole for the rest of the day.
Story time about how my husband ran away with his brother's wife on their wedding day. Disclaimer, this is not my story time. It was sent to me on Instagram. My husband has been a serial cheater for the 5 years that we've been married. He started cheating on me 2 weeks after we got married. And no, he never bothered to hide any of it. Anytime I found out about an affair, I would ask him and he would be honest and tell me that yes, he was having an affair, but that he would end it. But of course I knew that once a cheater, always a cheater. So I never, ever, ever trusted him after that. I wanted to even the playing field, so I decided to have my own affairs. You see, I wanted to give him a taste of his own medicine so that he could see what it felt like. And he actually got psychotic when he found out that I cheated on him the first time. He even locked me in a room for 5 hours and questioned me. I told him that if he was gonna cheat on me, then I was definitely gonna cheat on him too. I know that this is incredibly toxic, but it was the only thing that I could think of to make him change his ways. That's when he finally decided that he would try to stay faithful to me for as long as he possibly could. But what do you know, 2 weeks later, he was already cheating on me again. He had a really rowdy group of friends and they would always go out to bars, so this is how he met these women. Of course, he'd tell them that he was single and these girls had no idea that he was married. So it's not like I could get mad at them. My husband is close to his brother and they would always hang out. When his brother got engaged and he met his fiance, I could tell that my husband was eyeing her from head to toe. That's when I told him that he needed to stay away from her, not only for me, but for his brother. And he swore that he would never ever do that to his own brother. But he could definitely do it to his wife, of course. We would see his brother and his fiance all the time. We would have dinners together, and that's when I started noticing that she was also staring at my husband. I would catch them constantly looking at each other. Eventually, I told my husband's brother, my brother-in-law, about the concerns I had of his fiance with my husband. He laughed and even actually got mad at me for suggesting such a thing. I told him that he would regret it if he didn't take action now. A few weeks before the wedding, my husband started acting really strange. I noticed my husband was acting really strange before the wedding. He started going out every single night. He wouldn't tell me where he would go and he would leave his phone in the house. Sometimes he'd come back the following morning. A few days before the wedding, I decided to confront him about it. I knew that I didn't want to stress him out before the wedding, but at the same time, I couldn't live like this. I had this worried, sick feeling in my stomach every single night and I would barely sleep knowing that he was out doing God knows what. When I asked him what was going on, he told me that I was overreacting and that he was just playing poker with his friends at his friend's house. I told him to call his friend on speaker so that he could confirm his story. That's when he threw a tantrum. He started slamming doors and cabinets in the kitchen, telling me that I was overreacting and that I needed to let him live his life. And he even mentioned divorce for the first time ever. He said he didn't want to be tied down to such a jealous woman. That's when I broke. I literally pulled out a list of all the women that he had cheated on me, the ones that I knew of, and I told him that he had broken my heart over 10 times that I knew of, and that I knew he would never stop and that the only thing that was fair for me was to at least have him be honest. That's when he hugged me and started to cry, and that was the first time I had seen him show any emotion towards my pain. He began to apologize and told me that he never meant to hurt me that way. We hugged and we just watched a movie and everything was back to normal. But I knew that nothing was back to normal and that he was hiding something. Finally, the day of the wedding comes and he is stressed. From the moment he woke up, he was pacing in the house, sweating. He even had 4 cups of coffee. I asked him what was wrong and he said that he was just nervous for his brother. We finally head to the church where everyone is already waiting. And when we get there, the first thing I see is the bride. She's standing outside the church with the suitcase. Without even turning to look at me, my husband tells me to get out of the car quickly. Without looking at me, my husband tells me to get out of the car as fast as I can. I asked him what was going on, and he opened the door and pushed me out. That's when the bride jumps into the car with her suitcase and her wedding dress. And he drove off as fast as he could. I kept yelling at the top of my lungs. Of course, the entire family runs out of the church to see what's happening. That's when my mother-in-law told me that the wedding had already happened, but we had arrived late. And that right after they were married, the bride took the groom aside and told her that she didn't want to be with him. Of course, he got really upset and they got into a full blown-out fight in front of everyone. When he asked her where she was going, she said she had a ride prepared. She grabbed her suitcase and apparently walked out, and that's when my husband and I pulled up. The groom and I were absolutely devastated. I kept calling my husband and he kept calling his wife, but of course they both ignored us. My parents-in-law were so upset that they even called the police to report his car stolen. This was in the hopes that they would at least find their car, but unfortunately nobody found the car on the streets. This led us to believe that they were probably hauled up at some hotel. This is when I remembered that my husband really liked this one hotel that was by his job. He always told me that he would go there for drinks with his friends. So my family-in-law and I show up, and as soon as we get to the hotel, I see my husband and his now girlfriend having lunch in the restaurant at the hotel. Of course, we confronted them. We were all yelling at the top of our lungs, and the hotel kicked us out. Finally, my father-in-law was able to talk some sense into my husband and make him realize what he had done. Not only had he ruined our marriage, but his brother's future as well. His brother was beside himself, so depressed, and kept crying. And my mother-in-law had to take a sedative in order to calm down. My husband came to his senses and told his girlfriend that what they did was wrong. He looked at me and begged me for forgiveness, but of course, I didn't speak a word to him. My now sister-in-law slash my husband's girlfriend, she decided to head straight to the airport and went back to her parents. It's been a few weeks now and my brother-in-law took her back. I still haven't forgiven my husband, but we're still living in the same house. I don't know what to do.
Story time about how my boyfriend is bullying me into losing weight.
Disclaimer, this is not my story time. It was sent to me on Instagram. My boyfriend and I have been together for 2 months. He's a personal trainer, so he's really into fitness. When we started dating, I wasn't super fit, but I definitely was toned. Unfortunately, I got the Rona, so I got fired from my job because I couldn't work for 2 weeks. I was super sick and I really became depressed. I basically sat on my couch for those 2 weeks and ate a lot. Before I knew it, I had gained 7 pounds. When I finished my quarantine, I finally was able to see my boyfriend. And when he first came into my house to see me, he looked shocked. He looked me up and down and said, "Did you gain weight?" I said, "Yeah, I probably gained like 7 or 10 pounds. And then he asked me how I could let myself go like that. I told him I was totally by myself, cooped up in my apartment, and I had nothing else to do but eat. And that's when he said, and I quote, "Well, we need to get you back into the gym to get you in shape again, because I don't want a fat girlfriend." I laughed because I thought for sure he's joking, but then he said, "Stop laughing, it's not a joke." My stomach sank and I felt like I was gonna poop my pants. I started to cry and he told me that I shouldn't be a baby, that he's allowed to be honest with me about stuff like this because it has to do with him being attracted to me. So in other words, he wasn't attracted to me anymore. That's when he went into my room, picked out a pair of leggings and a sweatshirt, told me to get dressed, and took me straight to the gym. He made me exercise for an hour and a half. Instead of getting upset about it, I decided to just take it in stride and go with it. I thought maybe I can get in the best shape of my life now that I have a trainer boyfriend. As we were working out, he kept commenting on my thighs. He said that they needed to have a gap and that instead of being muscular, I was super soft. Again, I started to cry. Part two is up. Part two of how my boyfriend is bullying me into losing weight. Disclaimer, this is not my story time. It was sent to me on Instagram. After he told me that I was soft at the gym, I started to cry again. I told him that he needed to be more sensitive towards my feelings and that I didn't want to be in a relationship if he was going to be like this toward me. That's when he said that he didn't want to be in a relationship with me because I had gained weight and that's not what he had signed up for. That's when he told me I needed to look around and see all the fit women in the gym and that he could have any of those girls. I was in utter shock. I just couldn't believe that he was talking to me like that and I had never seen that side of him before. The more I cried, the angrier he got, but finally he said, "Okay, I'm sorry. Let's just do 20 minutes on the Stairmaster." That's when I told him I didn't want to work out anymore. Mind you, he had already had me at the gym for an hour and a half. That's when he said, "Fine, I'll take you home, but I'm coming back to the gym." The whole way home, he stayed quiet and gave me the cold shoulder while I cried. He pulled up to my house and I got out of the car and he literally sped away as fast as he could. He proceeded to give me the cold shoulder for the next 2 days. I finally broke and texted him telling him we needed to speak. That's when he said we could talk at the gym. I agreed and he went to pick me up. But the first thing he wanted to do at the gym was put me on a scale and weigh me. I told him absolutely not. Part three is up. Part three of how my boyfriend is bullying me into losing weight. Disclaimer, this is not my story time. It was sent to me on Instagram. He was trying to force me to get on the scale so that he could weigh me because he wanted to see how much weight I could lose in 1 week. I kept saying no, but then he said fine. Then he handed me a piece of paper and said, "Here's the diet I want you to follow for the next 4 weeks. I grabbed the piece of paper and just put it in my purse. Then he has the audacity to get mad at me for not even looking at the diet. He said that I was disrespectful and that I didn't even look at the diet and that it took him hours to write all of that out. And then he said the thing that crushed my heart. He would be embarrassed to take me around his friends and family with the way that I looked. As soon as he said that, I ran out of the gym and walked home. Of course he followed me and told me to get in the car, but I refused. I finally got to my house and he called me. I told him I needed some time away from him and that his behavior was extremely toxic. And that if I didn't have a problem with my weight, neither should he. That's when he said that he was accustomed to only being with girls that were super fit and even had abs. He told me that at first he wasn't convinced if he should date me, but I had a really pretty face. And that he was willing to overlook the fact that I wasn't super fit. He's a total narcissist, but I'm still in love with him. I tried to break up with him, but he said no. And he's still insisting that we just go to the gym together at least. I don't even know how to respond to him. What should I
say? Am I wrong for refusing to walk my daughter down the aisle? My daughter, 26 female, and I haven't spoken in years. When she was 15, we found out that she wasn't my biological daughter and my wife had cheated on me years ago with a friend. As it turns out, the so-called friend was suddenly interested in playing dad. My wife and I divorced, my daughter learned the truth, and I told her I still loved her no matter what. Of course, she was interested now in getting to know her biological father, and while it hurt, I tried to accept that. She started pulling away from me after that. Even when trying to still do things together as a family, she was no longer interested. The last straw was when she was 20 and living at my house. We were arguing because she had dropped from her college courses, hasn't done anything for 3 months, and was mad because I told her she either needed to go to school or work if she wants to stay here for free. She told me I'm just, I can't even read it, it's so mean. She told me I'm not her real dad, so stop pretending like I am, and she'll just go to stay with her real father. That broke me, honestly. But I told her if that's how she really feels, then there's really nothing left to say between us. And she did move out to go live with him. I was depressed for a very long time, and I drank a lot. My son, 24 male, was my only reason to keep moving forward. For the first couple of years, I reached out to my daughter. She wanted no contact, and I learned to accept that and moved on. It helped me find more peace in my life. My son stopped talking to her for a while over this and was angry with her. They still chat sometimes, which doesn't bother me at all. Through him, I learned her biological father died in October 2019. She reached out to me first, saying she knows that we haven't talked in a while, but wants to ask me if I'd be willing to walk her down the aisle. After a pretty long message about how much she hurt me in the past with her actions, I told her no. She didn't want me to be her father anymore, so I learned to no longer view her as my daughter. This turned into a fight between us because, according to her, it's not her fault she wanted to know her real dad. And I agreed with her it's not, but what was her fault was how she treated me ever since. In my mind, I know if he hadn't passed, we wouldn't even be speaking right now. It ended with telling her I hope she enjoys her wedding, but I want no part of her life. My son told me she's ranting to my family that I'm ruining her date and she thought parents are supposed to love their kids unconditionally. Oh, what a gaslighting bitch. Fuck her. Oh, I can't be swearing so much. Sorry. My brother seems to think that now I am being an asshole and that this is my chance to be in her life again, but I have no interest in that. Still seems that everyone has a strong opinion on it and that I'm making it difficult for my daughter to have the wedding she wants when it would mean a lot to her. My son is on my side, but the comments are still wearing me down, and just for the sake of my sanity, am I being an asshole?
I was born with club feet, which is a foot deformity that caused both of my feet to be turned in towards each other. These are photos of surgeries I had as a baby, but these surgeries are not done anymore because they work in the short term, but they have long-term complications. Growing up, I was extremely active. I played basketball for 8 years. I did gymnastics for a little while. I rock climbed all the time. I played volleyball at my school until things started to get bad. My feet became very painful. I couldn't walk on them. I used crutches and boots until eventually I was in my wheelchair almost full time. This is when I started having surgeries on my feet again, and my surgeon and I discovered that my feet had slowly been deteriorating over the years. I had severe arthritis, only 15% of the cartilage left in my feet. I had flat foot. My ankle was literally falling off of my heel, among so many other issues. So I spent most of my time in high school trying to walk on boots and crutches and recovering from surgeries, and it was all super painful, but the worst part about it was that, like so many of you have commented, everything looked fine, so people thought I was faking it for attention. Until I obviously wasn't. I had my first leg amputated, and then my second one a year later. And it was a really difficult decision and recovery process. I doubted myself a lot and questioned if I made the right decision because I did have to decide to do this. I wouldn't have died if they didn't, but I would not have had anywhere near the quality of life I have now. So after my recovery, when I started to be able to walk better, I went back to doing all the things I loved. I worked on my footwork almost right away because I was determined to do everything that I had done before. I started running. I was back in the gym. I taught myself how to skateboard again. I was really proud of that one. And now I'm training to be a Paralympic snowboarder. None of this would have been possible if I had kept my legs. But now I can do anything that I did before, and then some. And I am so, so much happier now after making that decision. So that's the story of why I amputated my legs.
This story time is about how my boyfriend exposed my nudes to everyone at school. By the way, we're calling him Keith. So I've been with my boyfriend Keith for 4 months. He seemed pretty cool and chill and very outgoing. He played basketball and was very popular in school. So when he started talking to me, I felt very special. But as time went by, he wasn't the guy who I thought he was. He was pretty self-entitled, cocky, and it got annoying. He expected everything to be handed to him. Anyway, throughout the relationship, he'd always ask for nudes, but I always tell him no because I'm not that type of girl to send any guy nudes. He'd always get mad at me and say couples are supposed to do that type of stuff, but I didn't give in. I'd always take pictures of myself because I liked my body, but I would never send them to anyone. One day, Keith comes over to my house. We chill for a little bit, and then my mom had called me. And then when I had came back, I saw him on my phone. When I snatched my phone from him, he sent the pictures that I took of myself and sent them to his phone. It get really reckless after this. This is part 2 of how my boyfriend exposed my nudes to everyone in school. So after Keith snuck into my phone and sent my nudes to himself, I got mad at him and told him to delete them. He tries to justify why he should keep them, but I say no because they were private. So then he shows me he's deleting them. After that, I kicked him out of my house for invading my privacy. Next day, I get ready for school. I text my boyfriend good morning as usual, but he didn't respond, which I thought was weird. When I get to school, everyone is staring at me. One of the basketball players at my school came up to me and said, "You're wild." I was like, "What?" When I get to class, one of the girls sitting in front of the class said, "Girl, you're bold," and I'm still confused. When I sat down at my seat and I opened up my phone, I went through Snapchat, watching everyone's stories, and I saw my nudes on one of Keith's friend's story. After this, it gets terrible. This is part 3 of how my boyfriend exposed my nudes to everyone at school. So after I saw that Keith sent my nudes to one of his friends exposed my nudes on Snapchat. I got upset. When lunchtime hit, I came into the lunchroom and everyone was staring at me. One of my best friends came up to me and asked me if I posted my nudes online. And I told her no and explained what Keith probably did. That lunchtime hit and we went around searching for him, but he wasn't there. I didn't know what to do, but my friends tried to convince me to go to the counselor, but I was embarrassed and I didn't want anyone to know about them or for them to tell my parents. I tried texting Keith on why did he do that, why did he send those people my pictures, but he just blocked me. I wasn't even sad about it no more, I just got upset. So I called my older brother about it and I told him what Keith did. And he said he'd be at my school at the end of the day and that he'll handle the whole situation. So school ends and everyone is leaving out. Me and my best friend walk up together to meet up with my brother. When I get outside, all I see is my brother and his friends jumping Keith. It gets crazy after this. Let me know if you guys want a part 4. This is part 4 of how my boyfriend exposed my nudes to everyone in school. Like I said earlier, I was supposed to be meeting up with my brother after school, but I saw him and his friends jumping my boyfriend Keith. Everyone was crowded around him, and you can tell that Keith was getting it bad. His lip was busted, 2 black eyes, hands were bleeding, and his clothes were ripped up, and he had bruises on his legs and arms. And all his friends backed up, and the one who posted the nudes wasn't there. By the time I reached down to the crowd, the cops came, and I'm pretty sure it was probably because the school called. And I was trying to stop my brother and pull him off of Keith, but him and his friends just kept going at him. When the cops came storming in, they all hopped out of their cars. They screamed at everyone, telling everyone to back up. By the time they reached the center, they arrested my brother and his friends, and they had to get an ambulance for Keith. My brother tried to escape, but they tased him and he fell to the ground. At this point, it gets really sad. To be honest, I don't even think y'all actually want to know what happened after that, but let me know down below.
This is part 5 of how my boyfriend exposed my nudes to everyone in school. So after the fight broke up, the cops were called and they arrested my brother and his friends, but Keith had to get an ambulance. Afterwards, I went home and my friends came with me. At this point, I had to tell my parents. They were really disappointed, but they weren't hard on me. They ended up going to my school, talked to my counselors and all the teachers about it, which was very embarrassing for me. They brought in one of the students, who was Keith's friend that actually posted the pictures. Some other stuff went down, but we were able to press charges, ask my brother, my parents bailed him out. But Keith tried pressing charges against my brother, but since I was already pressing charges against him for exposing my pictures, he ended up having to drop the charges because it was too much going on. Some other stuff went down in between, but it's too much to explain. But at the end of it all, I won the case. Keith and his friends ended up having to leave the school, and of course I broke up with Keith, but my news will forever circle around the internet.
Story time about how I found out that my boyfriend was trying to get with another girl on Valentine's Day. Okay, there's a lot that goes into this story time, so let me break it down for you real quick. I was a sophomore, and my boyfriend and I had been dating for about 4 months now, and he was a junior. Well, there was this girl that he was for some reason obsessed with in his Spanish class. She was a freshman. And I know you're probably thinking, oh, well, how did you know he was obsessed with her? Well, he would Snapchat this girl 24/7.
Even his friends told me he was obsessed with her.
So I talked to him and I told him I was uncomfortable with how much he was talking to this girl. And he said, oh, okay, I'm sorry, I'll block her. Now, I didn't ask him to do that, but it made me feel more confident in how he felt about me. Well, Valentine's Day comes around. And we didn't talk all day until he came to pick me up. I wished him a happy Valentine's Day and got left undelivered. So we get to the restaurants and we decide to put our phones at the end of the table so that way we would be more focused on each other. Well, he goes to the bathroom and then I see this name pop up on his phone. Like for part two.
Part two. So, like I said, I saw this name on his phone, and there was something special about this name. So, whenever I kept streaks, I would put the word streak, and then an emoji, and then the person's name. And he got the idea that instead of keeping her name, he would put it as streak. So I was like, that's really fucking weird. And at first I was like, what the fuck? So I opened his phone, and what do you know, it's from that girl. And she was replying back to a big paragraph that he sent her. And we had school that same day. So at 6:30 in the morning, this girl got a big paragraph from my boyfriend about how she's such a beautiful, amazing girl and that she deserves somebody who's gonna take her out and buy her flowers and stuff. And how if she wanted to go out to dinner, let him know. He took an extremely long time in the bathroom, so the waiter came to our table. So I ordered $300 worth of food for myself. So when he came back, I told him that I had to go call my mom and I left. And he was stuck with a $400
bill. Story time about how I broke up my best friend and his girlfriend. So it was our sophomore year in high school, and my best friend and I had known each other since we were like 8 years old. And I've always had a crush on him, like anytime he would get a girlfriend, I would try and break them up. And it would work.
Well, our freshman year of high school, he started dating this one girl.
Well, when he started dating her, he distanced himself from me because she didn't like how much time we were spending together. So a few months go by and my birthday's coming up. And mind you, within these past few months, we only seen each other like twice. And he had me blocked on all social media. Well, our parents were really good friends because we lived in the same cul-de-sac. So my mom invited him and his parents to my birthday party. So at the end of my party, my friends left and him and his parents stayed. And my parents really didn't care if I drank alcohol, so we had like a whole bottle of vodka to ourselves. So we're in the basement and we're taking shots together. Well, I got him super drunk and he fell asleep. And while he was sleeping, I went on his phone and like for part two. Crazy ass story time about how my best friend's parents walked in on me sleeping with my best friend's brothers. And yes, I said brothers. So my freshman year, I had became best friends with this girl. And she had two older, hot-ass brothers. One was in college, and one was a senior. Well, it was Christmas break, and her older brother from college was home. And my parents let me go with them to Florida for Christmas break. They had a super nice beach house, and I was sharing a room with my best friend. And the boys were sharing a room. And our room was connected because there was a bathroom in the middle. Well, my best friend got super sick the first like 3 days of the trip, so she didn't do anything with us. So I was hanging out with the boys all the time. Well, the one night we were on the deck and we started to play truth or dare. And one of them asked, would you sleep with us? And I said, yeah. So at around 3 a.m., I snuck into their room and things started to get real nasty. There are kids on this app, so just use your imagination. And things started to get really loud and we woke their parents up, like for part two. Part two. So we thought that we woke their parents up. And we heard someone walking up the stairs, so I ran into the bathroom, hid, and they asked if everything was okay, and I was just like, oh, I'm not feeling good, I think I caught whatever my best friend has. So they went back downstairs, and we thought they went back to sleep. They were never asleep. So we decided to go onto the deck and finish the nastiness that we were doing. And I was like, oh, okay, you know, like, we don't have to be that quiet now. Because their bedroom was in the front of the house, and the porch was on the back of the house. And we were on the second floor, and below that, there was another porch with, like, a fire pit and everything. And I could see below us. Well, out of the corner of my eye, I thought I saw somebody walk into the house. But, stupid me, I just ignored it. Not even a minute later, I hear the sliding door open. And I hear, and we all turn around, and everybody's standing there. So they sent me home and told my parents. But I didn't get grounded, because low-key, my mom knew I was a hoe.
sixth grade teacher asked your class the other day how many of them were Trump fans. And most of them not knowing what a Trump fan was and, of course, wanting to be liked by their teacher, they all raised their hands. Well, all except for little Johnny. The teacher looks over at little Johnny and says, Johnny, why are you being different again? And he says, well, because I'm not a Trump fan. And she says, well, why are you not a Trump fan? And he says, because I'm a Democrat. She says, really, why are you a Democrat? He says, well, my mom's a Democrat and my dad's a Democrat, so I'm a Democrat. She says, oh, really? Well, what if your mom was a moron and your dad was an idiot? What would that make you? Johnny smiles and says, a Trump fan.
Story time about how I came out as bi to my parents. Disclaimer, this is not my story time. It was sent to me on Instagram. By the time I was 12 years old, I definitely knew I was bi. By the time I was 14, I'd already had a girlfriend and a boyfriend, but my parents did not know any of this. When I was 15, I even had a girlfriend for a full year. She would come around the house and I would say that she was my friend. But one day my mom walks in on me and my friend making out on the bed without our shirts on. My mom was so horrified that she actually ran out of the room. Later I explained to her that we were just playing a game and that it was popular at school. I basically convinced her that I was not bi. Or at least I thought I did. Later on that day, my dad comes to my room and basically asks me if I like girls. I swore up and down that I didn't. Then when I was 16, I found myself having two girlfriends, don't ask me how. Again, they would each come over and I would just say they were my friends. I thought I was home alone, so I invited my girlfriend over. We start fooling around and that's when my door opens. My dad is looking at me getting it on with another girl. Part two is up. My dad walks in on me while I was fooling around with the girl in bed. Mind you, I'm a girl. Disclaimer, this is not my story time. It was sent to me on Instagram. Keep in mind, I had half of my clothes on. My dad literally picked me up from the bed and threw me out of my room. Then he kicked my girlfriend out. It was definitely traumatizing. My dad called my mom and told her to rush home. They interrogated me for 3 hours. I told them I'd had girlfriends and boyfriends. They were more than shocked. They finally calmed down and I was able to go to sleep. 2 days later, my dad tells me to pack my suitcase. I asked him why, but he wouldn't tell me. Then he drove me to a camp that promises to help your children who are bi. Instead of being afraid, I told my dad that I would try my best. I lasted about 2 days there. They basically made us do Bible study, and I was made to feel like a perv. So I packed my little suitcase and I left. So of course, I packed my suitcase, climbed two walls, and I was free. That's when I heard a really scary alarm. Part three is up. I thought I was free, but then I hear an alarm sound. That's when I heard footsteps behind me. I started running and I got to a main road. Luckily, a bus was pulling up right on time. I get on the bus and I go straight to my girlfriend's house, which was about 2 hours away. That means they would have already told my parents I had escaped. Well, when I get to my girlfriend's house, my parents are already there. But guess what? My parents weren't there to pick me up. They were there to drop off all of my things. Yep, that's right. They kicked me out of the house. Thankfully, my girlfriend's family were super cool and they let me live with them. When I turned 18, I got an apartment and a roommate. My entire family stopped talking to me. It's been 4 years since I last saw my parents. I recently got hired at my dream job. So I went to my parents' house and I told them. I also came out to them properly. At least this time I was not yelled at. I speak to my mom on the phone every now and then, but I feel like I should talk to my dad again. What do you guys think? I just want them to accept me.
So it's another day at VS, but this time it's semi-annual sale. If you've never shopped the semi-annual sale, it means that bras, panties, fragrances, clothing, swimwear, everything goes on sale at VS, while certain items get marked down for really good prices. But Victoria's Secret loves to plaster these signs that say $3.99, $14.99, and in very tiny letters at the bottom of the sign, it'll say the words, and up. This means that all the panties in the bin are not $3.99. They're $3.99 and up. They can be all the way up to $7 or $10.99. Same thing for the bras. It'll say $14.99, but the most expensive bra could probably be $34.99. So this lady comes over with her bag full of sale items, full of panties, full of bras. She's too busy to be bothered with me, so I'm just ringing up her items. She's not even paying attention to the screen. Finally, I announce her total as being around like $400 or $500, and she is in shock, like, wait, what? Part two is coming. So I kindly explained to this lady that everything in the bin was $3.99 and up or $14.99 and up, so the prices may vary. She gets pretty annoyed. She's like, I went and picked up all this stuff, and the sign says that it's $3.99 and $14.99. That's the price I want it for. I'm not taking anything else. I'm already like, here we go. So I say, Miss, I'm really sorry about the confusion, but the prices are marked on the individual tags, despite what the sign says. I said, I can go through the bras and possibly look for the ones that are $14.99 and all of the panties that are only $3.99 if that will make you happy. But no, that wasn't good enough for her. She's pretty annoyed, and of course, as per usual, she wants to speak to a manager, and I kindly tell her the sale price is a sale price. Unless it goes down, that's what it is. First, she says, I'm not going to take any of it. Delete it all. I say, okay. Then she decides, just kidding, after I've already deleted it, she wants it all again. So it's another day at VS. We had a promotion for a free bag. If you spend $75, then you get a free bag or free tote. That's something that often happens at BS. So this lady comes in and she's super excited. She's shopping around, racking up her bill so she has enough money to get a free tote. Little does she know, I'm at the register giving away my last free tote. She comes up to me like, hey girl, I got my bag full. I got my 75. I'm ready to get my tote. I'm like, I'm so sorry, miss. I actually just gave away the last one. You would have thought I just told her that I murdered a family member of hers because she was tight. And she's like, oh, really? So what are you about to give me? Because I'm spending 75 today. So what do I get for free? She's like, a shirt, a perfume. I need something. I'm not leaving without it. Like, miss, I'm sorry. We don't have it. It's up to you if you want to spend the $75, but we have no more gifts. It's while supplies last. So after debating back and forth with her, like, I'm sorry, I can't just give you a free perfume. I can't just pick a shirt off the wall and give it to you. If you look at the coupon, it's this promotion is only while supplies last. So she's like, well, can you call some of the other stores? I want to see if they have the free bags left. I'm like, sure. I mean, I guess I can call, but they're not going to let you just come to the store and get a free bag. You have to spend the money at their store. She dismissed that idea pretty quickly after she realized that she would have to go from our mall to another mall to possibly get this bag. And she didn't have any time to drive. So she just decides to refuse to leave the store until somebody gets her something because she is just so entitled. Of course, I have to get my manager involved and he's like, look, let's just get this lady out of the store. Give her something. What do we have back here? So I'm digging behind the register and we just so happen to find this old tote bag, not the one that we were promoting, an old one. So she spent the 75 and got that random tote bag just to keep her quiet. So after debating back and forth with her, like, I'm sorry, I can't just give you a free perfume. I can't just pick a shirt off the wall and give it to you. If you look at the coupon, it's this promotion is only while supplies last. So she's like, well, can you call some of the other stores? I want to see if they have the free bags left. I'm like, sure. I mean, I guess I can call, but they're not going to let you just come to the store and get a free bag. You have to spend the money at their store. She dismissed that idea pretty quickly after she realized that she would have to go from our mall to another mall to possibly get this bag. And she didn't have any time to drive. So she just decides to refuse to leave the store until somebody gets her something because she is just so entitled. Of course, I have to get my manager involved and he's like, look, let's just get this lady out of the store. Give her something. What do we have back here? So I'm digging behind the register and we just so happen to find this old tote bag, not the one that we were promoting, an old one. So she spent the 75 and got that random tote bag just to keep her quiet. So I'm looking at this dirty, stinky bra and I'm like, what am I about to do? So I'm picking it up with tissue paper, I'm analyzing it, and finally I'm looking in at the date and I see that it's an old bra that we don't even make anymore. But you know, VS will pretty much take anything back because they love to keep their customers happy. So you know, I have to call my manager on the walkie and get his permission. He has to take a look at it, but as per usual, we took it back. And she went home with a brand new bra. And to be honest with y'all, I'm happy because that bra was filthy and dirty and smelly and she needed a new one. I said, sis, you should probably pick up a few before you go. But it is what it is. I'm happy she got a new bra, but please don't return nasty, dirty, used items. Like, it's so gross and I hated having to deal with that when I worked at VS. If you have a question about VS, a question about my story, leave it in the comments below. Also, follow me for more VS horror stories. One time, I was behind the register at Victoria's Secret. This customer walks in and immediately everybody spots her as a red flag. She's just picking up items, throwing them in her bag, not looking at sizes, not looking at colors. So everybody's like, Everyone's on their walkie like, watch this customer. She's coming to the fitting room. She's headed to the cash wrap. Somebody get her. Check her ID. Get her. She has a bag full of stuff. And guess who gets her at the register? Me. So she comes to my register and she dumps out her stuff and you know, we're having a regular conversation. Hi, how are you? Yada, yada, yada. Her total comes up to probably between $700 to $900. It was expensive. My manager is at the register next to me, talking to me on the walkie. Ashley, make sure you get that ID. Don't matter what she's using, make sure you get that ID. So I ask her for the ID because she's paying credit. Why do you need to ask for my ID? Just take it, run it. I'm like, no, ma'am, I'm sorry. I need your ID for the purchase. She starts to raise her voice at me. So she's raising her voice at me and I'm like, but I just couldn't, y'all. So I was like, I can raise my voice too. Do you want to play this game? Cause I'll win, promise. And she's like, oh, well, what time do you get off work? And I'm like, I'm closing. I'm actually getting off at 11. Would you like to pick me up? And then she calls me stupid. She's like, you're fucking stupid. And I'm like, okay, you know what? I'm gonna eat that.
Then she calls me a dumb bitch. So I took a deep breath and I said, fuck you, you dumbass bitch. Your broke ass can't even afford these motherfucking clothes and you over here trying to scam me. Fuck off my line. And honestly, me and her just started going back and forth at each other like, my manager's like, go to the back. I'm still cursing her out as I'm walking to the back of the store. I really thought I would get fired, but I actually didn't.
I'm not dangerous. Love, love, love.